Among Woodland Cemetery's peaceful grounds, there are some gravestones that do not mark the graves of the dead. Instead, they mark memories that the families of soldiers wanted to preserve in stone forever, memories of sons who went overseas to fight a war and never came home. Woodland Cemetery is home to over 60 of these stones, all belonging to people who served between 1914 and 1918 and died as a result of the Great War. The First World War, as it would later be dubbed, was the bloodiest conflict in Canadian history, taking the lives of 61,000 Canadians. Though many people held romantic and heroic notions of war before this, no one had ever faced a conflict on this scale, and the disastrous outcomes erased their naive views. Though Canada was fighting for the mother country, Britain, the First World War introduced the notion of Canadian national pride and instilled a sense in Canadians that they had the strength to distinguish themselves as a nation on the world stage. The Canadian war effort was almost completely driven by volunteers, and many Canadians were eager to give their service, time, and money to help their country. For a relatively small country, Canada had an impressive turnout, with over 600,000 Canadians serving in the war. They fought in the trenches, in the Air Force, or to heal those who had been wounded. They took part in famous battles such as Ypres, the Somme, and Vimy Ridge. London, Ontario made its own contribution to the war effort. Some of London's families who lost sons chose to memorialize them at Woodland Cemetery, ensuring that they had a place to grieve and find closure. One of these soldiers is 2nd Lieutenant Horace Edgar Kingsmill Bray. As a boy, Horace attends Galt Collegiate Institute and discovers that he has an aptitude for poetry. He develops into a passionate student who believes in the pride and honor of the school. Though Horace wants to further his education, he is well versed in military matters, having spent 2 years as a private signaler, and decides that it is his duty to serve and defend his country. He enlists on the 20th of January, 1915. He is 18 years old.
He wore twin stripes of gold upon an empty tunic sleeve. His eyes were blue, his face so young, one hardly could believe that he had seen the death and hate that makes the whole world grieve.
Horace sailed overseas on the SS Caledonia on June 9, 1915. He fights amid the mud in the trenches. On September 29, 1916, he is wounded by shrapnel. It hits him in the left leg and in the forehead. He stays at a hospital in Manchester until he is well enough to return to service. In 1917, Horace falls ill. He is admitted to the hospital again for a serious eye, ear, and nasal obstruction, tonsillitis, and nephritis, or inflammation of the kidney. He is granted disability leave for a while, and requests to be transferred to the Royal Flying Corps when he regains his health. Through all of this, Horace writes poetry. His poetry does not hide the pain of war or the devastating effects that it had on the young men who went over. We can only wonder if Horace himself experienced the crushing depression that he writes about, or if he aligned himself with the patriotic glory that he also betrays.
He passed me in a crowded street. We did not meet again. He showed me in a sudden flash our England's pride and pain. And when all else is long forgot, his memory shall remain.
Horace eventually recovers from his illness and joins the Royal Flying Corps. The First World War is the first time planes are widely used in combat, and soldiers in flying regiments have the shortest life expectancy of any serviceman. Horace begins his training, but he is fated never to make it to the battlefield. The day before he is to go to France to fight, he is killed in a mid-air collision during a training flight. It is July 9, 1918, and he is 22 years old.
He faced the east where the night blackness grew and speaking died. O God, now hast thou portioned out my share of the great feast. I have supped deeply thy world so fair, more I wear a beast. For I have known the dawns of summer days, the crimson eaves, how I have loved to track the forest ways, the very leaves. Rain benediction on my sleep, as now they will in death. O earth, how hast thou given to endow my soul with breath? I cry thee greeting and farewell, I say, as the sun dips low. I cry thee greeting for another day, and now I go.
Just down the road from Bray's stone lies a monument belonging to one of London's most prominent families, the Scatcherds, showing that not even the rich and powerful were immune to the destruction of war. Born in 1895, Lieutenant John Labatt Scatcherd is the son of Alan Scatcherd and Catherine Labatt, the eldest daughter of the famous brewing family. Born in New York, John moves to London with his mother in 1901 after the death of his father so the pair can be closer to the Labatt family. He is only 7 years old. In his late youth, John works as a civil servant, planning to follow his uncle's footsteps into a government position. War changes all of that. In August of 1914, just after the war breaks out, John writes home to his mother from a hotel he is staying at in Montreal.
Dear Mother, when it was announced Thursday volunteers would be called for, I began to think seriously of what part I might play. I weighed both sides carefully. I fully realized the seriousness of the situation, but I cannot bear the thought of staying here. I've seen thousands of young men leave here, of only reading or hearing of things done when I might be in it all myself. I have been thinking of nothing else since Thursday. I have looked at all sides of the question from my own point of view and from others, and came to one conclusion, that I would do my very best to be in it. I have set my heart on this, and what a great, great disappointment it will be if you refuse your approval. I am sure you would say yes. Your loving son, John.
Having lived as a widow for several years, raising her son and suffering ill health, John's mother does not respond favorably to his proposition. The next day, John receives a letter from his great uncle in New York, whom his mother has made aware of the situation.
My dear John, I received a letter from your mother, and for the life of me, I cannot see why you wish to join a regiment at the present time. You cannot possibly have weighed this matter in the manner in which you should, or you would never want to get into this fracas. You cannot appreciate what this war means. It is one of absolute extermination, and is far different from anything that any Canadian or Englishman, or in fact anyone, ever dreamt of. Men will be mowed down without seeing each other, and the loss of life is going to be appalling. You say in your telegram that many of your friends are joining. That is undoubtedly so, because your friends are young. If they were not young, they would not join until an absolute requirement takes place. As well, you are old enough to appreciate the fact that your mother went through an exceedingly serious operation just about a year ago, and she is anything but a well and strong woman today. Have you stopped to consider what this means to her, the worry that it will cause her, the nights that she will lie awake not knowing what this means, and the constant dread that she will live through for fear of something happening to you? I want you to think all these things over, and to wire me, at my expense, what definite decision you have come to. Very sincerely yours, RCS.
The passionate words of his great uncle make John more cautious, but in the end do very little to deter him from his chosen path. Instead of enlisting right away, John proceeds to training in Kingston at the Royal Military College. From there, he writes his mother often, describing the drills that he is doing, the weather, and how hard he is working to catch up to the other men in his class who have experience with military work. When he is shipped overseas to France, his mother packs up her belongings and moves to England so that she will be closer to him. John proves an extremely effective soldier and works his way up to the rank of lieutenant. He serves over 2 years on the Western Front and is only 2 months away from the end of the war when he is wounded on September 3rd, 1918. He dies the same day. He is 22 years old. After his death, John is awarded the Military Cross and the Military Cross First Bar for conspicuous gallantry and devotion to duty. Upon his death, his comrades construct a custom wooden cross to go on his grave. In 1925, this cross was shipped back to Canada. It now hangs in St. Paul's Cathedral with a plaque commemorating John's life. John Scatcherd was not the only decorated soldier from the London area. Major Cuthbert Finney McEwen lived in Byron on the city's most famous sheep farm. Growing up, Cuthbert is trained by his father Robert in the ways of farming, traveling southwestern Ontario to compete in agricultural fairs and gaining an illustrious reputation. He later graduates from the Ontario Agricultural College. He enlists in 1915 and goes overseas on June 8th on the SS Caledonia, the same ship that Horace Bray is aboard. Once he is in France, Cuthbert is transferred to the Canadian Light Horse Infantry due to his expertise with horses. He fights at Passchendaele, Amiens, and Canal du Nord, and becomes good friends with Billy Bishop, Canada's top flying ace and a Victoria Cross recipient. He quickly climbs the ranks of his regiment, as he is universally loved by all of his men. He is even mentioned in many letters home, which testify to his continual good cheer, his genial, kindly, and helpful manner, and how he never loses track of the fact that the men come first. In addition to his exceptional service record, Cuthbert also leaves behind a record of his thoughts and feelings during the war, in the form of a tattered black journal he keeps and hundreds of letters that he exchanges with his family and friends during his time overseas.
Dear Mrs. Rain, this is not all fun, of course, over here, especially this last month. For the combatant troops, it has been pretty much a case of life and death, and I am sorry that for so many, it has been the latter. But there have been many humorous happenings through it all. Some of the funniest things I have ever seen happen have been under conditions where you would least expect them. But if the Germans ever kicked the laugh out of our men, there would then be some doubt as to the way the war would finish.
Though he tries to maintain a positive perspective on things, he is also very honest about the pain, depression, and hopelessness that he feels on the front.
Dear Bobs, it has been nice and warm for a week now, and it sort of gives me the pip, or willies, or whatever you call that listless trouble. My dejected state is also increased by a very quiet day here on the job. From my point of view, today this war is proving a failure. Our duty is one of waste in the largest sense, waste of men, animals, and supplies. The nation that can stand the waste the longest will win the war. Dear Mrs. Rain, we lost poor old Wodge the other day. He and a sergeant and three of our men were all killed by one shell. This old war never came home to me as it did the day we brought him out. It is hard to reconcile yourself to seeing such a man as that cut off with all his life before him. I had made up my mind he was a man I wanted to keep for a friend after the war. He would never have made a fortune, but he had a faculty of leaving everyone with whom he came in contact better for having met him.
In October of 1918, both Cuthbert and his family feel confident that he will make it home, as he has survived over 3 years of active service. He books off a week of leave and is about to travel to England when his superiors ask him to do one last patrol duty. While proceeding on foot near the front line, he is struck by a shell fragment and dies 10 minutes later, on October 21st, 1918. He is 29 years old. It is only 2 weeks before the end of the war. After his death, McEwen is awarded the Distinguished Service Order for gallant and distinguished service in the field. His family, especially his father, were heartbroken and requested that a photograph be taken of his grave in France and sent back to their farm in Canada. This request was granted, but it was not enough for the McEwens, who purchased this large monument to put in Woodland Cemetery. McEwen's family also saved every letter and every record of his service and archived them all at the University of Western Ontario. The Beckers, one of London's founding families, also stores relics from their family history at Western. In the late 19th century, Henry and Catherine Becker live at the Thornwood Estate in London, located at 329 St. George Street, which still stands today. Henry, the father, is a leading barrister of the city and is mayor of London for a time. The couple has 3 sons, Henry Campbell, Alexander Lorne, and Archibald Valency. Alexander, the middle child, is chronically ill in his youth, and when the First World War dawns, he is unable to enlist. Henry and Archibald, however, both decide to serve. Lieutenant Colonel Henry Campbell Becker is second in command of the 1st Battalion and is the eldest of the Becker brothers. He practices law before opening his own stock brokerage business and joins the city militia in 1899. He is noted for loving outdoor sports, cricket, boxing, horses, and cross-country riding, and acting in amateur theater. He also adores nature, often remarking on the beauty of France in his letters home during his service. Though he has many passions, all agree that what Henry loves most is his home, his mother, and his family. Despite this love, when the war is declared, Henry's sense of duty to his country is stronger. He is one of the first men in London to enlist, and is immediately appointed to a high position in Canada's 1st Battalion, a position befitting the heroism and reliability that is attached to his name. Archibald, the youngest Becker brother, is highly commended throughout the city for a number of achievements, but he doesn't enlist when his older brother does. Archie is a surgeon, physician, and a veteran. He attends the University of Western Ontario School of Medicine, but leaves his studies to enlist in the Boer War in South Africa at the turn of the century. His personal friends include Winston Churchill, Charles Dickens, and William Makepeace Thackeray. During his time back in London, he serves as an alderman on city council and is one of London's coroners. Archie may not have enlisted alongside Henry due to his recent marriage. In January of 1913, he marries Flora Adine Wilson, also known as Toppy. The next year, the couple has a son, who they name John. It is possible that Archibald wants to remain close to his young family. It is also possible that he is war-weary and disillusioned after his time in South Africa. Everything changes when, on June 15, 1915, the Becker family gets word that Henry has been killed in action at the Battle of Givenchy. The story that reaches the family tells that Henry is standing on a parapet, leading men in a charge, when a bomb detonates and shatters both of his legs. He is taken off the battlefield and is being transported to a field ambulance when he is shot through the neck by a German sniper, along with the men who were carrying his stretcher. His wounds were not presumed serious at first, and he survives for several hours before succumbing to his injuries. Those who are with him say that he is cheerful until the very end. He is 41 years old. Henry's death is seen as the ultimate self-sacrifice, as he knew the danger of the situation before going into it. His last words, reported by many, are said to be, "No man can live in that fire, but I'll go." The Becker family contacts the military to see if they will ship Henry's body back to Canada, but it is too late. Henry is buried the morning after his death with full military honors in France. In lieu of a funeral, the family holds a memorial service for Henry at St. Paul's Cathedral, and the church is so full that many have to stand. The Reverend delivers a stirring sermon, telling the story of Henry's death and asking, "Soldiers, is there one of you that would not do likewise? What an ideal to hold up before the Canadian people for all time." The City Council passes a resolution of sympathy, but it is not enough to ease the pain of the family he left behind. It may be this pain or guilt that prompts Archibald to enlist in October of 1915. As a trained doctor, his services are sorely needed, and he is accepted immediately as a surgeon major and is sent to Quebec in preparation for service in France. He leaves behind a 2-year-old son, and likely unbeknownst to him, another son on the way. He is only in Quebec for a month before he contracts double pneumonia. He cares for his patients up until his illness overtakes him, at which time he admits himself to the hospital. His wife and mother travel to Quebec to be by his side. He dies on Christmas Day, 1915. He is 36 years old. A month prior, he had signed his own medical examination form, declaring that he was healthy and fit for active service. Because he died in Canada, his body is transported back to London for burial. He is buried at Woodland Cemetery on December 28, 1915, with full military honors at a funeral attended by thousands. The flowers for the service alone fill 4 carriages. Archibald did not live to see the birth of his second son, Alexander, who was born in May of 1916. Both Alex and John grew up never knowing their father, though John eventually became a doctor to carry on his legacy. The Becker family and their community were devastated at the loss of 2 brilliant sons and all of their potential. A double plaque commemorating both of the brothers was mounted in St. Paul's Cathedral and remains there today. These are just a few of the countless soldiers whose names are carved in stone on Woodland's grounds. 100 years ago, these men fought and died for their country. Their stories have lasted through time and have reached us here today, making it our responsibility to honor and remember their sacrifice, and the sacrifice of the other 61,000 Canadians who died as a result of the Great War.